knowledge of the Italian immigrant community in the Western Washington area. And he would welcome people to the Casa on a daily basis when he was feeling well. Because Joe, for years, he was battling a very serious life-threatening illness for years. But when he was well, he would always be here. He would always be here welcoming people. It didn't matter if they were Italian, Hispanic, Black, White, Irish, it didn't matter. He was welcoming people here, and he was lovingly open to telling stories about the immigrant histories of the Italian-American community, and was also cognizant of the plights and the trials of other immigrant communities, not just Italian. It's not just about an Italian immigrant community. It's about the immigrant community as a whole. And he never judged. He was opinionated. And he could be stubborn at times. But you know what? In the time that I knew Joe, most of the time he was right. He said, they should do it this way. Because one of the things that he always told me, he says, and I agreed with him, and I think I was... I'm a pretty stubborn guy myself. We need to stay together as a community, and we need to keep this going for our children. And this activity is not just for older people. This activity should be developed and perpetuated for our youth. And all of the activities should be focused on not only perpetuating the history, but the meaning behind the history and how it's relevant to our youth. Joe exemplified this. And I remember Joe, sometimes he couldn't even get out of bed, but he would lift himself up. He would come over here and he would sit in that chair and he'd welcome every soul that entered this facility. Joe has been involved in the Italian immigrant community his entire life, beginning with working with his father at his the deli and grocery store and meat market, all the way to the end when he passed away peacefully in his sleep. I can't stress enough how dedicated an individual, and he left an indelible mark on my heart. It'll never go away. With that being said, I think It's really important that we, you know, take what Joe had to offer us and continue this legacy. Make sure this Casa survives. Joe was a part of the original Casa. He was on the board. He was always a cook at the banquets, the Italian banquets. I always waited, Joe, what do you want me to do now? I hear Joe bark an order out. At the Sons and Daughters of Italy, Lodge 1390. He was always there when he could be. Even when he wasn't feeling well, he was always there. He had a chair. We have a picture of it. We have a chair with his hat on it at the last meeting on Thursday. He was also a critical part of the picnics, the annual picnics we had. And he'd done that for decades. Decades, and I can't even, maybe 7 years, 8 years, I've been involved in this thing of ours, not La Cosa Nostra. But I just hold love in my heart for Joe, and I hope all of us can at least set a partial example, because none of us can ever measure up to what Joe represented to our community. And I thank you for listening.
So true. That's the message came across. So let's now, one thing I want to show you, that's why I put the Longano there. Longano there is the place from where the forebears, Giuseppe Di Pasquale, that's the place where they came from, and he always talked about it. And so we were thinking maybe to go there and visit it, but that's, we'll do it anyway, in his name.
Sure.
So they said, well, that's a little bit wrong. So I want to give you a bird's eye view of what we are going to touch, and then see how far we can go. We are going to talk about the idea of these Italian stories is to talk about immigrants, history, cooking, opera, traveling, politics, Italian politics. And we'll have a small test during this inaugural event. As far as the Italian politics, I suggest that you get some wine before I start. That's why I have wine here, because you will get really bored. So I want to thank you. There is, believe it or not, there is a team behind. Besides these two guys here, the young generation, we cop them in, that are doing tech support, among other things. We have Teresa, Tessa, Chris, and Kathleen. So this was a group, there was also Joe part of it, but Tony's part of it, Tony Codo. I cooked up this group because we had to start somewhere, but this group will become, in my view, and maybe you have to reshuffle and rethink a little bit, will become the driving force besides the scheduling, the vision, and other suggestions, other things. Obviously, you guys, if you want to participate, then with time, we will inform you. You can participate because this is us. I'm not talking about Garibaldi on the horse, or Columbus, or the big generals. I'm talking about us. That's history about us. That's why we call it Italian stories. We didn't call it Italian history. We call it Italian stories because these are our stories. We own it. The Italian history will be the context, and the American history, for that matter, in which certain things happened. Obviously, we need to understand that. And hopefully, we are going to make an effort to clarify that. So, basically, we'll give in this event, in this particular event, we'll give you some highlights of all this stuff. I'm reading because it's hard. That's what. So, in what we want to accomplish, it's about our culture. Understanding our culture, our traditions, and in the final analysis about our identity. That's what binds us, basically. Doesn't matter if we came yesterday or if we came two centuries ago. We have the culture that binds us. And being aware of this, in my view, in our view, will make us better citizens, wherever we land. Is not, and then we go inside those details. I'll explain what I mean. In future event, so we will uncover the stories of our forebears, the ones that came to find a better life in America, discover the challenges they had, the aspirations, the stereotypes. No, I don't know how to tell you. You know that. Discriminations, the fact that you don't speak your language, can't speak your language, that kind of stuff. But that's another detail we'll go inside. We will dip in the heart of the Italian culture. We'll learn about the values that motivates us, like the family values. And what really made our forebears survive in that challenging society where they barely spoke the language. Moreover, we will talk about the different regions of Italy. Believe it or not, Italy is like the size of Arizona, but you know, it's so different. In my view, that's what makes Italy great, even though for some it's a problem. For me, it's a blessing, if you understand. So we'll talk about opera. We'll give you a little taste about opera, by the way, so we'll see. And we'll talk about Italian politics. As I said, when we talk about politics, I'll warn you. So we'll start with the wine, and then I'll tell you the details. You want to know. Maybe you don't want to know. So anyway, so that said, yeah, let's go forward. Why Italian stores? Why Italian store? A little bit I told you before, we named this series, this project, Italian Stories, because it's not just about Italian history or American history in general, the dates, the battle, you know, the general and this and that. It's about the immigrants. It's about us. It's also about our experience as individuals. So we can relate, connect the dots. And I think that's something that the younger generation would benefit from. Otherwise, we lose track. And that's probably interesting for them. We'll try to introduce a complex situation that could be in a very succinct manner, if it's possible. But that's not an easy task. But we hope that many of us can come forward and help in the process. Now, in my case, I'm a little bit, I don't know if I'm lucky or unlucky, because I have one foot here and one foot over there. And so I can see I have friends, family over there with whom I work too. And maybe one day we can connect online. But so I can understand where they come from and the problems they have to face, that they are facing. And on the other hand, I can understand the situation here and some of the problems we have here and the challenges we have to face. I think if we can get the bridge, maybe we'll do part of our job. Maybe one day, who knows? But that's an idea. So then why is, so that's why Italian stories is not just the dates and the ballots. So what is history? History does not exist for you, for us to like or dislike. It exists so that you can learn from it. That's why history. Better yet, it offends you, because then you will be less likely to repeat it. History is not yours to erase. It belongs to all of us. So, but we have to understand it, we have to be. It's a challenge. Sometimes we have to leave behind our preconceived ideas or things that we don't understand. We have to challenge ourselves. One more step. So that's something that I like. If you don't know where you come from, then you don't know where you are. And if you don't know where you are, then you don't know where you are going. And if you don't know where you are going, you are probably wrong. So, Lauren, one more thing. So why is, to me, history is this. It's not dead letter. To me, history is looking back to our history, to our background, to our culture, family culture, tradition, and all that. So then we can move forward. And so you cannot invent, this is an Italian writer wrote that was specifically direct to the southern Italy. But that applies to all of us. If you cannot invent, you cannot invent the future if you are not aware of your past. Because then you know pretty much where you are going. It's a compass, in other words. If you don't have that compass, probably we'll buy and we'll drink the stuff that somebody is telling about us, and we cannot allow it. So, one more step. we are here. Okay. So, what before? We have something before that?
This one?
No. Yeah, go ahead. Ah, non si sente. Okay. No, go ahead, Laura.
Okay.
Fine. So I asked myself, so after so many years in the United States, who am I? Am I Italian? I'm Japanese? Who am I? And that's this thing, there's this melting pot idea that came about a century ago and so forth. I said, well, no, I don't really think that I'm melting anywhere. I'm not melting anything here. Maybe what applies to me, and that's for me, you know, because I'm, as I said, I came, I'm first generation, let's put it this way. I have a contact over there and over here, obviously. So to me, the best metaphor, if you want to talk about cooking metaphors, so I say, for me, the metaphor is a three-layer cake, where the bottom of the cake is the Neapolitan layer, because I come from Naples. My first language is the Neapolitan language. My first language is my mother language. My first language is Neapolitan, and I love it because Neapolitan is so complex and expresses things in such a way that you cannot say it in Italian or in English, for that matter. And I thought, many people ask, but it's Neapolitan language, so I brought a couple of books to show, just show it. These are books written in Neapolitan. Neapolitan is a language, it's not a dialect. It's a mistake to say the dialect, because it's a written language older than Italian. And also, this is many of the poems here are also made in music. Some of these things are songs.
So his mic is picking up.
So, and that's for Neapolitan. So then there is the Italian layer. The Italian layer, obviously, I to learn Italian. And Italian learned, obviously, I learned Italian. I learned the Italian culture. Obviously, added more complexity to it and more flexibility, if you wish. So I learned the Latin, for instance, and then Italian along with it. At junior high, at my time, they were teaching Latin. We studied Latin. We read a little bit about what Caesar was saying in a more elementary way. And then Italian, the Italian language, or the poem, or the stuff, and all that. So, okay. And then, little I know, I came here. And then there was this other layer, the English, the American layer. That's another culture on top of the Italian culture, on top of the Napoleon culture. So to summarize, that's the way I see myself. And maybe that something could be useful to understand the interactions without becoming humiliated, because I celebrate that, by the way. I don't apologize for that. That's what makes me who I am. And by the way, when I have problems in the American society, I go down one layer. So what the Italians are doing here? You know, I don't think the Italians are doing right here. So let me go another layer down. Let's see what the Neapolitans do. And sometimes, believe it or not, I find the answer there. And then I come back. In fact, I found many of this connection with the immigrants here just because of that. That's why I clicked with Joe, because Joe understood. And that's the three-layer cake. So now let's see part two Italian stories. As I said, Italian stories are not about just history. History is the context, the American history, Italian history, but Italian stories are about us, about people, our forebears, ourselves. Let's give you an example on what is the meaning of that. So this is not, don't read any political message. This is Mario Cuomo, governor of New York.
In Italy, there was no school in the town that they came from, Nucera Inferiore in Tramonti. There was no church where they were. There was no hospital. They came here lying to their parents about what they would do after marriage, because the generation before my mother and father's generation had come here. They were the fabled generation that had been told that the streets were paved with gold. And this has been used over and over, but it makes the point very nicely. They were told the streets were paved with gold, and they came here in the late 19th century and discovered the streets weren't paved at all. and that they were expected to do the paving. And they weren't paid in gold. And so they got disgusted, went back home, and made their children promise never to go to the United States of America. And so they had to lie to come here. They got married. They had a secret plan. She got pregnant. He came, went to Jersey City. He was a ditch digger. Came at exactly the wrong time, 1929. He was out of work. Mama followed him with a child, Frankie, who had been born in Italy. And no money, no friends, no Medicare, no Medicaid, no government to help them. And that's where they were. And one of their children, named Mario, died of what later it was figured was a cold or a fever or something. But there was no clinic. There were no friends. She had no place to go. There was no government helping her. And so she lost Mario. Eventually, she had another one. But that was in Queens with the help of a Jewish gentleman, Kessler, who gave my father a job in the back of the grocery store, lifting things and doing the heavy work, because Kessler himself had had a heart attack and couldn't do it. And a friend of my father's from, who was in Jamaica, Queens, but who had come from the same Paez as my father, said to Kessler, these people are there, they have nobody. Put them in the back of the store. I was born delivered by a midwife behind the store. And all I could think of as I grew in those years was my mother, my father, and how they got through it. How did they manage to do it? How did they eventually manage to have four children, get them all educated, and live a very good, solid life, never with any elegance, never with any extraordinary comfort? So that's the background. And now I go to these two people and say, so, Ma, you know, maybe if we go into politics, we can make some changes, you know, so that everybody has a good education, you know. And they listen. They said, well, my father said, oh, wait, do you want to be now into politics? And I said, yeah. He says, man, all of your life you've been honest, and now you want to be into politician. And I said, well. And I felt awful, and I said, you know, and I said, oh, no, but you don't understand. And they didn't understand. They never saw a politician in South Jamaica. Nobody ever came. Nobody ever would. We didn't have a policeman on the street in South Jamaica. We identified ourselves by our police precinct. Where are you from? 103rd precinct. Ooh, I'm not going to mess with you. That's where we came from. And so with all of this background, I could understand how they were disappointed. I thought about it overnight, and I had a plan. I went back to them the next day, and I said, especially to my mother, who was particularly bright, I said, Ma, listen, in Italian, I said, you know, this is the way you get to be a judge, by being a politician. And see, the image of the judge meant everything to them. The judge is up there. The judge wears a gown. You wear, you know, you have to wear a suit. The judge is looking down on you. She says, not bad. And she went to Andrea, her husband, and she says, you know, maybe he's not so stupid. And maybe this is the way you get to be a judge. It's God's honest truth. And so we went, and we started, and we lost an election, and we lost the second election. And then by some miracle, we beat Ed Koch against the odds, and it was wonderful, you know. And then we beat Lou Lerman, and the guy gets on the mic, and now Papa's gone. He had died a few years earlier. But Mama was there. She was still there. She's next to me on the podium as the voice booms out. And not only has he done this and that, and this, he is also going to be the first Italian-American governor of the state of New York. Hey, everybody cheered. And I turned to my mother, and I said to her in Italian, how do you feel about your baby now? And she looked up and said, isn't no bad, but when are you going to be judge? She died at 95. Thank God she didn't know. I twice had the chance to be a judge and said no. She never would have forgiven me for that.
I'm from Avellino. Many of us come from Avellino, Mirabella, all those places. I come from a place in province of Avellino, close to Nolais. This is an old town, older than Rome, by the way. But Baiano is the name of the town. So it's the last town in the province of Avellino, then the province of Naples starts. So anyway, we are all there. That's the area of immigration. Hard lot of immigrants, and they came to this country, and they still know, by the way. That's all it is, but that's another story. And so now, not because I want to compare myself to Mario, but you know, why not? I mean, I did my part. That's what's good about the United States, right? Why should we be? That's who we are. So let me give you a little story about me. So you know a little bit more. And that's an example of the stories we are looking for. These are just snapshots because I can go into detail some other time. So that's where I was born. This is a Baiano. This is a hill. It's called Jesu e Maria, the name of the hill, a little hill. And that's the house where I was born. This was my grandparents' mother's side, the parents' house. And that's where they live, sons and daughters. My mom was born there. I was born there. And but this house here was rebuilt before in the 80s because it was an earthquake. The old house was destroyed, but I still remember of the old house. There is a little a date sketched on a little balcony saying 1813. So my house, where I was born, was older than Italia. Italia was born, let's say, in 1860, but that's another story that we'll talk about, and it will be probably interesting. So we were there before Italy was born, before Italia. Italia, by the way, is younger than the United States, it's about 162-63 years, as a modern state. So it's not Columbus, it's not Leonardo and all that. Those were not Italians, they were Florentine, Genovese. Italia came afterwards. But we can talk about that. Then on the other side, there's a little picture of the place from where my wife's parents came from the mother's side. And my wife is American, born here. The parents from the mother's side came from this place called Sassoferrato. What was it from? A provincia di Ancona. Ancona province, region of Mark. And Mark is in the central part of Italy, on the Adriatic side. So they came here at last century with the big flow of immigration, and they were part of the flow of immigration. I didn't know that. And then there's another story along with that is with my father-in-law. We can go into detail, so I want to tell you a little bit of this story, my history, connect to the American history, the American family history, because my father-in-law was a captain of the American army during World War II. And so he went there and kicked the ass of the fascists and the Nazis, really. And so he's one of those that freed Italy, and Rome in particular. So that's another story in itself. And he told me about, oh, do you know this? Do you know that? So how come you know all these towns? When I was born, he was there before I was born. So anyway, so now let's go forward. One more. So this is a little bit about me. So I graduated at the University of Naples. This is my alma mater. I graduated at the University Federico II, the Department of Engineering Department and Computer Science. I graduated in computer science in Naples, and this is one of the oldest university in the world, you can say, in Europe, but probably in the world. Let me give you a little bit of history about it. Frederick II was a whole Roman emperor, king of Sicily and southern Italy. There were two separate kingdoms, but he unified them. So he was one of the most influential middle-age rulers. He ruled over southern Italy and Sicily and was a very cosmopolitan, you know, ruler, especially at the time. So he promoted tolerance among different religious and cultural groups, like creating an environment for where Latin Christians, Greek Orthodox Christians, Muslims, and Jews were all together. Now, looking at what's happening around us, it would be nice to have somebody like that, you know, with those ideas in mind. Anyway, so Frederick II played a very important role in the founding of the university where I graduated. In 1224, recognized the importance of education. 1,000 years ago or more. And he established the institution which became a center of learning and in that period of time. The University of Naples contributed significantly to the intellectual and cultural development of the region and beyond. What is the legacy left? The legacy left, while some say, well, he was an autocrat, but his reign was left a legacy, lasting impact on southern Italy. I can tell you that, that's why I went to the university. Southern Italy, Sicily, and the broader Europe. You know, this guy, you know, extended his reach all over Europe, shaping really the political and cultural landscape of the time. So, done by the fact that a southern Italy or Mezzogiorno, as we say, is backward. What are we talking about? This stuff, thousands of years, without going back to the Greek time and all that stuff, that's the modern time, more or less. Problem is, there is no understanding of this stuff. If we get, start understanding this, we balance the real stuff. Real culture, real understanding, and then we can move forward in the modern world and make progress. But we need to know that. Once you know that, you have a second thoughts before you make a judgment. That's why I was saying history is important. It's not there to serve you. It's there to make you think. And so, anyway, so one more step. And now it's the time.
I'll wear this now.
Now's the time, Laura. So, because the second layer, Italian layer, so I was in the army in Italy. We were with my army buddies giving loyalty oath. These are the Bersaglieri. Italian always are so excited about Bersaglieri. Bersaglieri means sharpshooter. And this is a very, it's an integral part of the Italian history, the Italian, mystic, you want to say. And for good reason. But I have to say, though, there must be some adjustments. But that's another story. But I didn't want to give up because that's my experience. So I don't let people say, No, that's my experience. That's how I've been. For me, it was a very learning curve. It was very also, how to say, when you go in the army, you don't make any fuss about stuff. You also have to go there and clean the latrine. It doesn't matter what is your degree. You do it because others do it for you also. So that's for an example, humility. So, and the connection that you create, you know. So, okay, let's go forward. So, to give you a taste of who the Bersaglieri are.
Ecco I Bersaglieri. Thank you.
But one specialty of the Salieri is that you have to run. It doesn't matter where you are, what you do, whatever. You have to go to the bathroom, you run. You run everywhere. So I cannot do it anymore. But I kept my head. And I think Laura is just wearing it just right. Garibaldina. Oh, no, Bersagliera. So, okay, one more step. Okay, here, that's my path to citizenship. So I passed from the immigrant, my Italian passport, to my legalized status of American citizen. Obviously, my name changed from Michele or Michela, like they say here, to Michael. And inside, behind the door, I made sure that the clerk there wrote, yes, this is Michele, but it's Michael in English. It's fine. But you leave your land. I like this little icon. This a sculpture, I think. A Spanish one, forget his name now. You leave, but you have in your, that's for the first generation. You leave, you have a hole in your heart. So where's there? Doesn't matter. So because you leave part of your life behind. Now this is here because you have YouTube, all the stuff and all that. But before you left, and that is always, you know, because you don't live the life of the people you left behind. No. Marriage and funerals and all that. And so that's always the case, my dear. I know because happened to me. But what you gain from leaving the stuff behind, your part of the reality behind, it's a new life. The new life that if you like it or not, it's what you are going to. Many times you don't realize. Don't realize the first time you come here that you are going to change.
Yeah.
That's what happened. So that's what happened to me. It took some time. I'll show you a little bit something. So let me. These are the companies I work for. Michael, I worked for the same company you worked for. I didn't know that. So at the Advanced Technology Labs was my first American, let's say the General Telephone and Telephone and Electronics Corporation, GTE, maybe some other people remember that, was the company I came here in the United States because GTE had a subsidiary in Milan. I worked in Milan for GTE. And they had a subsidiary in Belgium too. So I came with, because there was a project, common project with the American headquarters. They created a new company, a new building, new farm, let's say, in Phoenix, Arizona. They start building some software, switching and stuff, just before the cell phones. So that's where I worked, and that's where I came here. And then the things changed, met my wife, things changed. And so then I started working at Advanced Technology Labs. I could have worked for Microsoft, but the timing was not right. In fact, Advanced Technology Lab was on Northup Way. And Northup Way was basically a couple of miles away from the original Microsoft that was there. So anyway, I worked for them. They built an ultrasound machine. I worked on some ultrasound machine, ultrasound software, the scanning, you know, they start building the first machine, ultrasound machines. Then I moved with the Siemens, they did the same stuff in Issaquah. Then I worked for Microsoft, Google, and Expedia. Then I got fed up and said, okay, I don't want to do that. You get told, you know, why? It's like growing, you cannot wear your shorts anymore. Anyway, so who am I? Concluding. So I realized that for the Americans, you always be an Italian. That's first generation. For the Italians, you'll be an American with the passing of time. I know that because when I've been into Italy many times, the first time, no different. Now, you know, I need to explain. Sometimes I cannot explain in Italian because I forget those words. And then I do. I lean on English. And then, what am I talking about? Anyway, and then when the metamorphosis is complete, you know that you will be an Italian American. I think it's almost, I'm almost at this stage. I think I am there. So, and that's the three-layer cake. So the three-layer cake I was telling you. So when I have a problem understanding stuff over here, so I go dig all the way down. Maybe most of the time I'll end up always on the Neapolitan layer. And that's where I can find some answers. And finally, and the other way around. So I find the answer, so I bring back where I am. Oh, maybe that can be adapted. We can do that here. I stop there. You know. Adesso, yeah, obviously, I need to follow the orders. So, yeah, let's take a break. Let's take a break, and then we'll...
I'll know what it is, right?
Okay, yeah.
I don't think we can be able to follow the fourth part that is about immigration. That's a little bit tough. So we'll reserve it for. Can you hear me down there? Can you hear? Can you hear? Okay. Hello. Hello.
It's just not very loud.
It's just not very loud.
Yeah. Can you increase the volume of the bar? There's volume bar.
Yeah, I'm increasing.
Hello, I'll scream. Let me scream. So I will. So we have two more parts: the history, Italian Peninsula history, and the immigration, Italian immigration. This, the immigration will be a little bit difficult to finish. So I don't want to leave it there. It's too important. We can do it maybe a session in another event in February, but before you leave, we can talk about, you can leave your email address on the paper there if you want to, and we can get in touch with you. So we are still working on the system. So, and then, you know, we will know. As far as the Italian Peninsula History Sneak Preview, yeah, Laura, we can go one more. When do we start here? So I said peninsula for a reason. I didn't say Italian, because Italia, history of Italy is different. It's just the last 200 years, 163 years, basically, you know, younger than the United States of America. That's another story in itself. So we are not talking about it. We are talking now, to give you an idea, because it relates also to the big four migration that relates to our forebears. So this I start, okay, everybody knows Pompeii, and so that's first level, that's where Pompeii is. And that's pastor Pompeii. So, so wine is everywhere, but anyway. So I don't know if they were making pizza there or what, but that's fast food in Pompeii. Italy is the size of Arizona, pretty much. So why there is no difference between Phoenix and Tucson? Well, because history, obviously, and because millennia that went by. If you see the image there, you see that Italy, these are the ancient peoples living in the Italian peninsula. From the south in the north, Etruscans, Umbrians, all the way down to the Romans were a little sliver. And I want you to know this one part. And then there are the Sannides. That's where mainly from Avellino come. That's the part called Sannio, still today, the area, Mirabelle, Plano, all those places. And then there is the place of Puglia. The other tribes there. And look at the name down there, various Italic people. That's the first time the name Italic came about. So the Italians were in the south, not in the north. So, but let's look at the name of the history. So that's where the name came from. So the Calabrese, the Sicilians, they should be proud of it, because that's where the name came from. So one more. Let's jump back in history 2,500 years. This is the map on the left is southern Italy, what we know as southern Italy. There was no southern Italy. Or Mezzogiorno, like the people in France, the day of the midday sun, that's what it means. So if you see all around the coast, there are towns. From Sicily, go Syracuse, Naxos, Agrares, and go all the way up to Crotone in Calabria, Crotone, right? And then all the way up to Napoli, Naples, or Neapolis, as it was called before, Cume, or Pesco. So these are old town colonies, big colonies. And the Romans gave the name to this area. They call it Magna Graecia, the Great Greece, because all the Greek left Greece and went to what became southern Italy to colonize. So like the people that came here to the United States, because Italy was not very populated that far. And so they went there and they basically exported culture, the monuments, all the stuff you go, and you go there and see all those monuments, that's where they come from. And that's where the Romans, and from them, the Romans learn many things. And Naples, by the way, I want to emphasize this because of the place I come from. Napoli, or Neapolis, the name, the Latin name, means new town. There was another town before they abandoned the Greek, and they found another one. That's why they called the new town. And Naples was part older than Rome. So there they spoke Greek. And the Greek culture, the same layout of Naples, when you see those straight line streets. In fact, they said, Via Tribunali, but that's where the pizza place is. It's a straight line, because that's the way the Greek builds a town, it's just square. Yeah. So that said, let's see what we have to, there's an history, a little history snippet here.
But it was the words of Apollo, transmitted through his oracle, that resonated most deeply with the Greeks. The oracle's predictions were transmitted through the frenzied words of an old priestess who interpreted the answers of the god. In a cave, the faithful awaited the response from the priestess, who, in a state of trance, recited prophetic words regarding the route to follow and where they should land. By following these directions, and probably those of sailors as well, the first Greeks reached the shores of the island of Ischia, in the Gulf of Naples, about 2,800 years ago. This marked the beginning of the Greek colonization of southern Italy, a vast territory given the name of Magna Graecia, which in Latin means Great Greece. But what was Magna Graecia? Basically, a group of polis, or city-states, whose wealth and power would soon exceed that of the Greek cities of the motherland. For the Greek settlers, used to the searing sun, aridness, and mountains of their homeland, Italy was a true paradise on earth, with its mild climate, abundant watercourses, and fertile plains. From the first cities sprang more. The inhabitants of Sybaris, founded by Peloponnesian Greeks, built Poseidonia, now Paestum. The people of Cumae, originally founded by Greeks from the island of Euboea, created Parthenope, which was to become the Athens of the West and is now known as Naples. Many of the residents of Naples are thus of Greek origin, direct descendants of those early settlers from Euboea. Naples is the commercial and cultural heart of the Mezzogiorno, Italy's south, the promised land of the ancient Greeks. Excavations for the new subway line through the center of Naples have turned out to be a window on the city's past. Work in such sites as Piazza Municipio has uncovered not only the old Aragonese walls, but also provided a chance to view a much deeper cross-section of the city's historical layers. Archaeologists from the Naples Monuments and Fine Arts Service have found numerous objects of Greek origin, such as the small fragment of an Attica vase dating back to the 4th century BC, decorated with the figure of an owl. Naples remained a Greek city for many centuries, even during the domain of the Roman Empire. The Romans were fascinated by Greek culture, and for them, Naples represented Greece, only 120 miles from their home, an open door to the allure and refinement of the Orient. Along the hills of Posilipo, a name taken from the Greek Posilipon, meaning the place where one's troubles end and rest can be found, the wealthy Romans built dozens of beautiful villas. Wanting to blend in, the Romans were happy to exchange their togas for the Greek pallium, to converse in Greek, listen to Greek music, and commission copies of Greek works of art. But Naples was not just a tourist attraction, a sort of amusement park for the Romans. The city was a capital of culture in its own right, where one could be born, live, and die in the manner of the Greeks, as Virgil liked to say. And it was here in Naples that the great author of epics wrote the Aeneid. Reproductions of masterpieces of Greek sculpture were much sought after, a big business at the time. Thousands of masterpieces from the Parthenopean school flooded the world, a veritable legacy of Greek art. The rich Romans paid, and paid quite well, to have imitations of famous works of art grace their villas and gardens. Another aspect of Greek culture the Romans appreciated was theater. To stand on the stage of the Naples Theater was the dream of every artist, the consecration of a life, a yardstick of success. The ruins of the Naples Theater have been found buried under later constructions. If you go down into the basements of private residences now standing on the spot, you can discover what remains of the theater, made famous partly because it was the site of an exceptional premiere appearance. The Emperor Nero himself made his debut as a poet in this theater. Nero loved both poetry and music, and performed many times on this stage before an audience whom he spoke with in Greek. Not far from the theater is a section of Naples named for the Virgins. Here, hidden behind this door, several yards underground, is a veritable treasure, a Greek hypogeum from the 3rd century BC. Hypogea were large subterranean chambers having the dual function of being a burial ground and a sanctuary. It was in the hypogea, for example, where ceremonies were held dedicated to the Oriental god Mithra, who was worshipped widely in Naples. This well-preserved one, the Crystallini Hypogeum, was built outside the city walls in an area that in ancient times was nothing but forests and fields. Everything here evokes Naples' ancient past, even though it is quite probable that the bones and skulls date back only to the 17th century, the period of the Great Plague during the Spanish rule. The discovery of the chamber only 100 years ago amazed archaeologists with its finely conserved state. There are votive edicula and delicately frescoed walls with figures still glowing in bright colors, and funerary urns for the mortal remains of the deceased. But what is perhaps most striking are the touching farewells to the departed, written in Greek on the walls. Here a father addressed his daughter, Aristagoras, with touching simplicity. "Goodbye, my beloved daughter." In the central part of the city is the spacious Agora. This plaza was the center of the social life of the city and the site of its market. It is incredible, but shops like these under the arcades have been here for over 2,000 years. And it is amazing to note that these narrow streets all have the same width, about 10 feet, and are spaced at regular intervals of 115 feet. The explanation given by archaeologists is that the modern-day streets still follow, more or less exactly, the Greek streets that were laid out when the city was founded 2,500 years ago. An example is the present-day Via Tribunali, which follows one of the two principal axes of the Greek city, and is one of the few broad avenues in Naples. The Agora is also famous for its magnificent temples. The Church of San Paolo Maggiore is the classic example of a Christian edifice standing on the ruins of a pagan temple. The ancient temple was dedicated to the Dioscuri, Zeus's twin sons, who were doomed to live and die on alternating days. Only these two beautiful Corinthian columns remain. But when it was new, the temple existed on a grandiose scale. We can once again view the great temple as it appeared almost 2,000 years ago. Thanks to a Greek inscription found nearby, it turns out that the temple was restored in the 1st century AD during the reign of the Emperor Tiberius, at the expense of two rich liberti, freed slaves who had become administrators of the imperial family's wealth. Through recent studies that established the ancient route of the perimeter walls, archaeologists now have a view of the entire ancient city of Naples. The city is of modest size, but completely encircled by a mighty defensive system of walls and turrets, fortifications that stood up to Hannibal and his elephants during the Second Punic War. Yes, even Hannibal paid a visit to Naples. From the top of the walls, you could have witnessed the dramatic events recounted by the Roman historian Titus Livy that took place in the area near the present-day Piazza Dante in the heart of Naples. Livy wrote, "The cavalry of the Neapolitan army succeeded with rapid sorties to sow confusion in the enemy ranks and thus forced Hannibal to abandon his siege." Walking through the streets of modern-day Naples, you can see traces in the features and gazes of the Neapolitans of the incredible mix of races that marked this corner of the Magna Graecia during the Hellenic and Roman period. Egyptians, Romans, Italians, Illyrians, and Africans were all accepted within the city walls into the community founded by the Greeks, an exemplary demonstration of tolerance.
Italy is a geographically positioned in the middle of the Mediterranean Sea. And so everyone wanted to get there because it was a good place to be. Fertile land, culture, and all that. As I said before, Italy is the size of Arizona. But because of history, because of what we are talking about, there are many differences various regions, and they are still, present today and affect the way Italian politics, Italian life is shaped. And we'll talk about that some other time. And that part, that situation also, we can go one more step. As I said before, Italia was created 163 years ago. What we know as Italy today is the same, it's younger than the United States of America, but we talk about that. It's an history that has to be dealt with some other times. But if you see these two maps, one was the ancient map. Now, the other one on the right is the map that was in place before Italia was created. And there are similar, almost similar stuff, right? The divisions in regional area. That means also that these guys, these people had different languages, different cultures. To me, being Italian from the south, being Neapolitan, and now American, I can see this stuff, this regional differences as what makes Italy. If you don't see that, you don't understand Italy. And instead of being a problem, in my view, it's a blessing, because that's where you get the culture, the foods, the languages, the combination of all these things that make Italy. That's why people like to go there. And so if you go from Venice down to Palermo, you have differences. You basically experience different things, and that's the blessing in my view. That's something that still has to be understood, unfortunately. And so that's the history that we can talk about. Because some of these differences made So briefly, I want to tell you a little bit about this, the list of these states, because then we talk about well next time around. If you see, there are basically eight states. Italy, an Italian peninsula, was made of eight states, starting from the south, where I like to start. I'm biased. Starting from, so this was called the Kingdom of Two Sicily. Why Two Sicily? Brief thing. At one point, the southern Italy, what we know as southern Italy, as I said, there was no southern Italy, was known as Kingdom of Two Sicily, Sicilies. Then the island of Sicily seceded and kept the name of the Kingdom of Sicily. In the meantime, the ruler of the mainland, the continent, like the Sicilian says, I need to read this because the kingdom of this decided to keep his title of King of Sicily. So there was King of Sicily there, a King of Sicily over there. Finally, there became one kingdom, and they call it Kingdom of Two Sicilies, the Italian Conference. Well, that's great. So that's why it's called the Kingdom of Two Sicily, but this is not like that in more general terms. There are details. Then there are the papal states, the church head states, and some states. Then there's the Republic of San Marino. Then there's the Grand Duchy of Tuscany. And then there is Duchy of Modena, going up, Principality of Parma. Parmigiano. Lombardo-Veneto. The Lombardo-Veneto here were under the Austrian domination. They were part of the Austrian Empire, Austrian-Hungarian Empire. And then the Kingdom of Sardinia, I don't know why Sardinia, that's another complication. So the kingdom, because Sardinia was, that's another story. I'll tell you that. I don't want to be fictitious about it. You know what the Italians' problems are? Because they cannot decide on the freaking names. If they would decide on the names, I would just be clear. We start from a clear slate. I cannot do that. So, that's another story. So, because of all these, because of many, the way the things came about, there have been many, separations. The power that be use their stuff not to their own advantage. And so many of the immigrants that came, and the immigrants came from all over Italy, don't get me wrong, Trentino, for instance, and Piemonte itself. So then the Italians always immigrated. But the big exodus after the unification in the 1860s came from the south. The south was a biblical exodus. Our relatives, the majority of us. So because, I don't know, maybe it was hard that they didn't understand what they were dealing with, because this story was so complicated that put all these people together was a complex task. And that was complicated, considering this. But no attention was given, in my view, to the differences. Instead of using that as their own, an advantage, they used, when I say they, as some people, they utilized the differences to their own advantage. And that gave, the big push to the immigration. And so that's why we are here, many of us, me included, because that was part of my reason to immigrate. It was also because there were no possibility of work in southern Italy. And as it is today, just the last 3 years, 1 million young people have immigrated from southern Italy. The projection is in 20 years there will be 8 million that will immigrate from Southern Italy. So rush before you want, if you want to have somebody greeting you down there, because pretty soon you don't find anyone to greet you in Southern Italy. If the Italians realize that, okay, hold on, so we need to do something else here. Maybe learning from history, maybe learning from our culture, use them to our own advantage. And so with that, I'm closing the deal here because I don't want to go any further. I don't want to take your time. So go ahead, sir. Please.
Actually, between 1880 during the Great Diaspora, about 10 million Southern Italians left Italy. 5 million ended up in the United States, and the rest of them ended up in South America and other places like Africa, and you know, worked for other companies. Literally 10 million Southern Italians left Southern Italy as a result of the Great Diaspora, which occurred between 1880 and 1920, ending in approximately 1924 with the Johnson-Reed Act, which was specifically passed, I know you'll probably get to this, specifically passed to prevent Chinese and Southern Italians from emigrating, immigrating to the United States.
So we need to address this matter, and we need to talk about this. It's not something that I matter, but I want to touch it. No, now I have another section. If I don't want to, I don't want to bore you. Just enough. But it's a complicated matter because that's a touchstone. It's related to Italian history, it's related to American history, it's related to what our experience, personal experience, has been. So you understand why people. Your relatives told you you don't speak Italian or Neapolitan or Calabrese. There was a reason why, and they were not. But we need to understand what happened. Because if we don't understand it, so we buy in the other narratives. Others will tell us who we are and why we had to forget our roots. No. So, okay. So, great.
Sorry.
So, I have a support team, luckily. So, young technical support. So our Italian roots, that's the idea, no, that's what we hope to communicate. I want to say one thing because it can be controversial. I don't like when people say in Italy or here, oh, the Northerners, oh, the Southerners. That's so wrong. Misses the point. Because there are good things in the north, there are good things in the south and good things in the between. Also in Sicily, believe it or not. What's again?
Arab, like Arab.
Yes, Arab. Yeah, so Sicily has a lot of influence, Arabic influence. Many words, Sicilian words, I don't speak Sicilian, unfortunately, I love the Sicilian language. Arabic. Like the Spaniards, Southern Spain, Alhambra, I don't know, my wife knows better. So, if you remember what I said about Frederick VII, he was what called these cultures. And Sicily was one center. If you go to Sicily, you see a monument, if you search. With Arabic, you know, influence. And the food, you know, the food, couscous, this and that, all the stuff. So that's what you got to say.
I thought it was like Georgia, like, bad.
Could be because there are some, and then we'll go inside there, because there are better connotations.
Yeah.
there are bad names going, but that's been stratified in the not very functioning brains. Also because they've been manipulated and used to divide people. So that's why I want to make sure that we overcome this. And what a better place than the United States, where people automatically were overcame these problems. But now we can go a little bit back and see how did we do it? And did we do it really? And all that stuff. Okay, so that's what I think would be nice to start, you know, working on. We are Italians. It happens that I'm a Neapolitan. I love it. So I don't renounce it. I celebrate. But also I'm Italian. And then I'm American. So you solve this riddle. It's not me to solve it. It's not up to me. If somebody has a problem with it, it's their problem. Correct. So our Italian roots connect us to the past. That's what we're talking about. And to the future, even more. The culture, the food, all the stuff around us, the language we speak. So let's learn Italian. Let's speak Italian. Of you wish Neapolitan or Sicilian on top of it. So, and don't be ashamed of that. Don't be put behind you all the shame and all the stuff. It's BS. So, these are part of us, a unique heritage to present, preserve, and share with the world, the entire world. So, what I'm not saying here, oh, we are the Italians, so. About the Spanish, this and that. That's a mistake. We are who we are. We bring to the table our heritage, our culture, our stuff, and we share. If you don't like it, it's up to you. We don't force on you, but you don't tell me that's not me. This is not us. That's who we are. And that's the castle. And to you.
I'll be singing one more song. It's called Visi d'arte, Visi d'amore from the opera Tosca, written again by Puccini.
Thank you.
That's not my job. So, do you want to do this? Yeah, let's do this. Just to close. That's the little level from our and that's where San Pablo is in the back. But that's their point, yes. And also,